Volker, thank you for joining us tonight for our little chat here on C compilers and VBCC in general. But before we jump into that part, could you introduce yourself a little bit by telling us what dragged you into computer business?
Well, I was interested in computers since I've been a kid. And I studied math and computer science. And so it was pretty straightforward to keep doing this.
Which computer did you had when you started the first one?
My first computer was a C64, like probably most of the people in my age group. And then I went on to the Amiga, where I had an Amiga 500 and later 4000. Then I had a digital Alpha workstation, and after that I landed with PC like everybody else, pretty much.
It's hard to avoid these PC machines.
Yes.
Did you already do programming on the C64, or when did that start?
Yes, not too much, but I did a little bit. I started a bit of BASIC, and then as this became pretty slow, I did a little bit of machine language programming on the C64. And yeah, I remember that my first machine language program, I still translated by hand because I didn't have an assembler at the time, so I had to calculate the numbers for all the instructions and everything myself. But it was a very small program, obviously. So.
Yeah, and what then sparked your interest in compiler designs?
I think one part was to have your own tools to understand really how your tools and the language works. And also what I found interesting that you really have a wide range of algorithms and data structures in a compiler. So you've got lists, trees, hash tables, you do sorting, graphs, bit fields, a lot of the different algorithms you learn in university, you can really use there.
And was that during your university time that you started with compiler and looking into that, or even before that?
I was interested a little bit before. I did a few experiments when I was sorry, still at school. But the work on VBCC started when I was at university.
And that was also on the Amiga, I guess.
Yes.
So, yeah, what do you work today? You still do work with computers, I guess.
Yes, after university, I worked as a kernel developer for a company that produced real-time operating systems for the automotive industry. Then I went back to university to do my PhD. And since then, since I left, I'm a freelance software developer, mainly embedded software, a lot for the automotive industry. And every now and then a bit with compilers, assemblers, and so on.
But that the compiler assembler is not your main business, so it's
No.
more a side.
Yeah, exactly.
What was the initial motivation to create the VBCC and the tools around it, like the assembler and linker?
The initial motivation for VBCC basically, yeah, was what got me interested in compilers. So just to try to write your own compiler, also to better get to know the C language, And it started as a hobby project, which basically it mostly still is. And when I got pretty good results, I discovered that it might be usable for other people as well. And then I decided that I could do a public release. It was, of course, you need people using the compiler to improve it, because all the testing and helpful additions you might need for the compiler, you don't know this all by yourself. And as a single person, there's no chance to get a stable compiler, pretty much, if it's an optimizing complicated compiler. It's very, very hard. So you need people who are using it, who are submitting bug reports and so on. So for that reason, I think it was important that it has at least some features which make it useful for somebody to use. So at that time, I think it was, there were of course other compilers for the Amiga, but some of them were commercial, so you had to pay pretty much. Others didn't really work very well on the Amiga, because especially GCC was just too big for the Amigas of that time, so it didn't run very well on them. And a few others lacked many features. They didn't support the higher 68000 processors, no FPU, and also most of them didn't have an optimizer. So I distributed or released the BBCC for the Amiga 68K. And this was also when I got to know Frank Wille, because I only wrote the compiler at this time, the compiler-generated assembly language. So I needed an assembler which I could use, and a linker. And I looked around whether there were any free ones which supported, for example, the FPUs and higher 68K processors which I wanted. And found the assembler and linker that Frank already had written at this time. So I contacted him, and that I could distribute them together with VBCC. So it's a complete toolchain. And since then, we worked together a lot. When later the Amiga got some PowerPC cards, so I also wrote a backend for PowerPC processors, which meant, of course, we needed a new assembler, which Frank also wrote, and a new linker, which he also wrote. And then when I started to work a bit with embedded systems, and I saw that there will be probably more backends coming, and we also had the problem with the 68K assembler, because that was written in assembly language for the Amiga, so it only ran on Amiga 68K. And especially when the PowerPC cards were there, we couldn't run it on the PowerPC cards. So you still had to, if you compiled for the 68K, but using the PowerPC card, you could do it for the compiler, because the compiler was written in C and could be compiled for PowerPC, but not the assembler. So this was not so very nice, and I still thought that we needed another assembler. And then Frank was a bit hesitant, and I decided to try to kick off this and wrote the first version of VESM. And it was designed to be easily retouchable, so it should support different architectures. It should also be possible to support different syntax modules, because the idea was to also replace the assemblers we already had. And for example, the Motorola syntax that was used for the 68K is pretty different from the syntax that was used for the PowerPC assembler. And I wanted to support them both, so I added the option to have different syntax modules and different output modules, because also the 68K Amiga had different object formats than the PowerPCs, and embedded, of course, on other things. So I started with that and designed it and did the first backend, and then luckily Frank decided to join this, and he started to write the 68K backend and then the PowerPC backend for VSM, so we could replace our old assemblers. And since then, he did a lot of work on VSM. He wrote several backends and syntax modules, added lots of features. So that was really great. And he probably contributed quite a bit more to VSM in the meantime that I did. And yes, as a linker, we have VLink, which Frank wrote. And that's his sole project, I would say. That's not the right wording. It's his project. So I have not really done anything with VLink. I'm just using it.
If you think about new targets, do you speak both together, or did just one of you start supporting or writing a backend for, let's say, a new CPU architecture?
Depends. Sometimes we speak together. If, for example, some time ago, I was approached regarding a backend for the 6809, and I already had written a backend for the 68HC12 embedded microcontroller some time ago, and I discovered those were very similar, so I could rather easily adapt the backend. And Frank already had a backend for the 6800, so not 68K, 6800. And then I asked him whether he would do a backend for the 6809, which he did. It was very great. So sometimes, if either of us would like a backend, then we approach the other and ask. But sometimes also, if I want to do a compiler backend where I'm interested in, then I will do it. And if Frank is interested in something, then he will do it. So,
yeah. Thank you. Compared to the big C compilers in the world, like GCC and Clang, what do you see are the main differences or benefits of VBCC compared to these?
I would say from the architectural point, I always designed VBCC so that it would work with a very broad range of architectures. For example, small embedded systems which are often very non-orthogonal, and segmented architectures. For example, VBCC supports different pointer types, pointer sizes like far pointers, near pointers, and so on. And it doesn't rely so much on a more or less orthogonal register set. And I think you see there are many kind of quirky architectures in the VBCC backends, like the set machine, or somebody at the moment is working on a backend for some old mainframer, Honeywell. I don't know what it's called, but one big mainframe from the, I don't know, 60s or 70s, which has 36-bit words. So this is, for example, something which VBCC can support, or the QNIS FPGA, which is an architecture that has 16-bit bytes and no 8-bit addressable bytes at all. So this is one benefit. Another thing is, of course, it's just VBCC, as it has to be maintained by two people for most of the time, we tend to keep it maintainable. And so it's not such a monster as GCC. It's very easy to get going. You don't need any big infrastructure. If you have a C compiler and you get the source code for VBCC, you can basically you type make target equals my target, hit return a few times, and then in a few seconds you have built VBCC. So it runs on many host systems. You don't need a Unix-like environment or many stuff around it. Also, for example, for the Amiga systems, the current VBCC versions still can be run natively on Amiga, or I think the Atari ST also, we have native ports for them. Whereas I think the current GCCs for Amiga are only cross-compilers anymore.
Yeah, I think at least on the original machines, there might be some really beefed up new machines like the Vampire that can run natively a GCC, but possibly the old ones.
Yeah, but I think they have never been ported to the Amiga anymore. Long time ago, there has been a native GCC for the Amiga, but what I have been told by some people who did VBCC backends and have tried GCC backends before, it seems to be pretty tricky to just compile GCC and get something running, especially if you're not just using a common target on a common host. I guess if you want to compile GCC for Linux Intel host on a Linux Intel target, it's probably easier, I don't know. But if you want to do something special, it's apparently more difficult. And I think also it's if you want to write an own backend, I think it's probably easier with VBCC, because the kind of how the backend interface is, if you start with a template backend, you can get going pretty fast. And I think it's more complicated with GCC. But I have to say, I never wrote a backend for GCC, so this is mostly based on the feedback I got from people. Maybe on the other side, there are people who write to the GCC mailing list that they try to write a backend for VBCC and it was so horrible, so now they're trying GCC. I don't know, but yeah, I rather guess not.
There's a comment in the chat that about anything is cleaner than GCC.
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
There's another question in the chat already that I relay. That is, would you be open to add support for Objective-C, meaning a different front end?
Open, yes, I just don't see me doing it anytime soon, just as a matter of time and effort. I'm not sure whether Objective-C, if you can get a Objective-C to C compiler, then maybe. But I just haven't really thought about it so far.
Yeah, that's, I guess the question was more than if someone would be willing to contribute, if that would be acceptable, not that you should do it.
Okay.
Which brings us to the one of the other questions in the chat already. How could external people contribute? Is there a public Git repository, or how is the way to collaborate on VBCC and the tools?
Usually just send me a mail if you want to contribute in some way. For example, with backends, usually people contact me if they either when they decide to try to write one. Many people also just write one and they only contact me when they have it basically complete and running and say, how now I've written a backend, do you want to include it or so? And some just keep the backend to themselves if it's just for their internal use. We also have, for example, for the assembler, some backends that have been contributed and some output modules. And of course, some of the most valuable contributions also always are bug reports.
And they should also be sent by email.
Yes, usually it's.
Are there other areas where people can help, like work on documentation, writing tutorials, doing video tutorials, maybe doing outreach? Or is everything fine as it is?
I think I'm open to any support. I know there are some video tutorials for VBCC, which people did. Usually they did not contact me, so they just did it on their own, so it's fine. Regarding documentation, if somebody wants to improve the documentation, of course, always valuable. Fixing my English or fixing outdated documentation, always valuable. And neither Frank nor I are the most keen to write documentation. But we try to keep it decent.
So here's a question in the chat. What are the areas of the compiler you are most excited to work on or proud about?
I think one area which I'm reasonably proud of was the basic architecture. So to basically write a compiler in the 90s on the Amiga, which still works with different targets, which people could use to write their own backends, which does generate decent code on all of those targets. And there's a lot you can get wrong, and you can if you choose a wrong design, it's easy to get yourself in a corner so that you're too limited regarding the targets you can support or new language features, optimizations, And also to keep it supported and stable over all these years and with quite a number of different backends and supported targets, considering that we're basically mostly two people. Compared to the kind of manpower that is put into GCC, for example, which is probably several hundred to thousand times as much. And personally, I like to work more on targets and optimizations. So the for example, front end parsing or so is something which for the most part I did when I started writing it, and then I took a week to do parsing and symbol table handling or so on, and since then I've barely touched it anymore.
Which might be good in itself. So if it just works, why change it? Yeah. When you work on VBCC today, what is your work environment? Like your editor or IDE or operating system you mostly develop on, and do you then test on an Amiga, on an emulator, or do you have the Amiga hardware still around that you then try out?
I'm working usually these days on Linux, on Intel or AMD processor, so standard. I'm usually using Emacs. So now I've one half of the audience is now on my side, the other half.
We have to live with that.
I'm not very don't care too much about the editor, actually, the other work as well. And I usually just a few shell windows and an editor. I usually don't need much more. For work, for example, when I have to work on code by different people, I more commonly use some kind of IDE, which helps usually a lot if you are dealing with unknown code. But for my own code, usually I know where everything is, so I barely need anything else. Regarding testing, for several architectures, I use simulators, for example, for the 6502 or the 6809. I usually run a test suite on simulators. For the Amiga and I think also ST, Frank does the testing usually, and I think he does it, I'm pretty sure he does it on original hardware. I still have my Amiga, which runs sometimes and sometimes not so well. It's not in very good shape anymore, unfortunately. So I don't usually use it. Even if I have to test something for the Amiga, I usually use an emulator.
Do you use a debugger sometimes, or even considered working on a debugger?
Yes, I'm using debugger. I've actually also at one time started laying out framework and an architecture for writing an own debugger to complete our tool chain a bit. Also was in discussion with Frank, but we didn't find the time and didn't start to implement it. But it would be a good addition.
Yeah, it would be a good addition. Can you a little bit explain how VBCC works, how it interacts with the linker and the assembler, and is it possible to substitute the assembler and linker with platform tools or other linker assemblers that might be available on the target.
Yes, actually, when I started with VBCC, obviously I didn't have any assembler and linker, so I used one from another compiler I used at the time. And also for some of the targets, which were only kind of side targets or experimental targets, I used assemblers, linkers that have already been available. And actually the front end still shows this in a way, because the front end gets a config file, which essentially contains printf format strings, which the front end uses to call the different parses, the compiler and then the assembler and linker. So you can use any assembler and linker usually instead of the bigger ones. And especially at the beginning, there was no VSM, no VLinks, or no what you could call standard assemblers for VBCC. And different assemblers were used. And today, when I support a target, usually I always use VSM and VLink these days. But some of the other people who wrote backends often use, for example, own assemblers. If somebody did his own CPU on an FPGA, and then he played already around and already had written his assembler, and then he decides, hey, I want to try a C compiler, and then usually he just tries to use the assembler he's already got. So that's very possible.
So there's a question here that came already two times, and for the audience, be assured that I don't skip questions. I like to order them, and some of the questions you've asked, I already have them in my list. So yes, now that this comes a question, does VBCC support fixed point? I think that's fixed point arithmetics. Like it was also mentioned before, 16.16.
No, I think that's not a C data type. So no, only floating point and integers at the moment. Is this a common extension?
I have no idea. I'm not. So we have to wait for whoever asked this question maybe to elaborate on that.
Okay.
Another question that came up is, does the VBCC come with its own libc?
Depends. I've got my own CLib. And for many targets, I do a port of it, and then it comes with. But for some targets, I never did. But all the well-supported targets come with a standard libc. Yeah.
Is it also possible then to link against some other libc, or is it then only the supplied libc that works?
If the other library has the same ABI, same format, then usually it's possible. I often did this at the beginning when I started supporting a target, and I did not yet have all that stuff. Then you can do it, but of course sometimes you also need some compiler specific functions. For example, if you need a function for multiplication or floating point routines, then usually this will not work with a different C library, because this is very compiler specific.
Okay, we got additional information about the fixed point question. I read here, it is a different way to handle the floating point format. Fixed point is supported by GCC, but only for a small number of microprocessors.
Okay, so basically you implement float as fixed point instead of real floating point. Just thinking whether you could just do this in a backend. I think it would be possible to support it. VBCC abstracts all the calculations it does in target arithmetic. So if you wrote the fixed point support functions that could be used on the host, so that because the compiler will do some calculations at compile time and they have to be in the same format usually as it's used on the target. So you would have to write those support functions and then you could implement it in the backend like that. Yeah, I have not done it, but I think it would be possible. But of course it would not be compliant to C. C requires floating point to pretty much work like floating point. But for systems where floating point is too expensive and if you know what you're doing, yeah, I think it would work.
Another question that came up is, what is the license of VBCC?
It's free for non-commercial use. The source is available, but it's not GPL or public domain. It may be distributed, unmodified, but no forks or so. And then there are some exceptions, for example, for the Amiga 68K. You can also use it for commercial programs due to a sponsoring agreement with individual computers. And something like this is also will be available for a few other targets, probably.
Are you aware of any notable large applications that use VBCC as a compiler on Amiga or on any of the other target platforms?
Well, of course, the most notable is VBCC itself, the toolchain, which is at least on the Amiga and Atari targets is built using itself. I think the Hollywood, it's kind of media programming language uses VBCC for at least some of its targets. There are of course a number of games. One interesting application that I came to know about recently is for an FPGA core, and there's a cartridge for the C64 called Chameleon, mm-hmm. Which you can put into the C64, and I think the original idea was to get a VGA output. But I think it turned out that you basically have to simulate the entire graphics chip and CPU of the C64 to do this reliably. So it contains an FPGA, which basically can run like a C64 even on its own. And so somebody also ported an Amiga core to this cartridge. From the MIST or MISTER system, maybe you have heard of. And it turned out that the FPGA on this cartridge was a bit small for that. And the MISTER also contains an ARM core on the chip, apart from the FPGA, which runs a lot of the user interface and whatever. And so one guy, Alistair Robinson, wanted to improve this because the existing Amiga Core port, I think, used a second instance of the 68K core on the FPGA, so it had basically two cores on it. And he wanted to reduce the space needed by this, so he designed his own CPU, which should be, on the one hand, small and only use a few, don't use too many logic cells, but also needed to have a good code density because the ROM was also very scarce. So he designed this chip, and then he wrote a backend for VVCC, which he could use to compile the firmware for his own chip. And then he managed to port an up-to-date Amiga core to this cartridge with support for emulation of separate graphics cards and the later Amiga graphics chipsets. And he then also started to build a framework to be able to port more cores of the Mr. FPGA to this cartridge. So I think that was a very, very nice application. Very, very interesting. So there are a lot of uses on the Amiga, but I don't know all of them. I can let it, for example, individual computers is using it for the software, for their drivers and what so on. They produce processor cards, 68 processor accelerator cards, and RAM expansions, and I don't know, a lot of stuff. I think for the assembler, for example, has been used by a YouTuber called Ben Eater. He used the 6502 VSM for his series where he did videos on building a breadboard 6502 computer. And he used the assembler, for example, which had quite good, yes, quite a good number of viewers, has a lot of viewers. So yeah, there's quite a number of things, or a few commercial ones, but I'm not sure whether I can tell about them, so I would have to look them up.
Yeah, but it's interesting to know that there are also commercial users of that. So clients of yours that use that for their embedded development.
Yeah, not, as I said, not my main business model, but every now and then there's a few customers.
There was one question about, do you use VVCC in your daily professional work, like if you need a C compiler?
No, usually the compiler is determined by the customer, and they are usually using one commercial with commercial support, and often they need certifications and so on. So no, not for those.
Okay. Does the VVCC already support the 68080, or how it is called in the Vampire, or is there any plans to support that?
I mean, of course, you, as it's 68 compatible, you can compile for it and then it runs. It does not support the extra features. I got approached some time ago at first by, I think, Gunther something, who designed this, and later by somebody else working on the team. But at first, they didn't have any fixed specifications for the extended instructions and so on. And it was a bit of a cumbersome communication, and then it just didn't lead to anything. As far as I know, I don't think they are very interested in any compiler support. As far as I know, no compiler so far supports these instructions. And I think VASM is the only assembler which supports them, which apparently Frank did because it was only a very small change. Yeah, but I think if there would be interest, they probably would have put more efforts into them, then there would already be some compiler.
Another question from the chat. What do you wish for VBCC in the future? Like, what is the future direction? And what is your current level of interest to work on VBCC?
At the moment, the last backend that I did was the 6502, which is what I'm currently probably working on at the most to support all the different 6502 targets with at least some level of support of libraries and adaptations. I maybe dive a bit more into FPGAs, where I think there have been a number of uses, and I have some ideas what I could do there. I don't have any long-term plans. I usually decide how much time do I have, what's just interesting for me, what looks like fun, or maybe where's a user base, where's a demand for something. For example, for the 6502, there are not many decent compilers, and it's quite in fashion at the moment, I have noticed. So a lot of those CPUs that I considered completely dead 10 years ago are now used a lot by the retro community. And then I just do what looks like fun.
Yeah, thank you for the 6502 port. I need to get to that as well, as I'm also coming from 6502 and still do some work on the Atari 8-bits. And need to get involved there and to look into that. But in a general question, how do you see the C programming language in the modern world with like Rust and Go and Swift and other languages popping up? Is there a future for C programming?
I think the foreseeable future, of course. My daily work is still almost exclusively C and assembly. The one thing for C is, of course, it's the compiler that's usually there for most systems. So it's basically the only language which is available for almost any target architecture that can barely run it. And there's also a huge load of existing software in C, of existing code you can use in C. So I think this is not going away anytime soon. Of course, there are lots of new languages all the time. but I think most of them are restricted to a few targets. So they are x86, Windows, Linux, Mac OS, and if you leave that, you lose 99% of existing languages probably. And from the language perspective itself, I don't know, but actually personally I like C a lot. It's pretty obvious that it's not a perfect language and it has quite a number of quirks. But to be honest, over the time, I think that many issues that are often criticized with C are not really that bad. And I think much of what is done in regarding design of new languages, and I'm not really deep into that topic, but much seems a bit of somebody has an idea what he thinks is worthwhile or is a good idea, and then he designs a language around it. But there's rarely any scientific evidence behind it. I remember when around the time when I started with VBCC, that was also the time where the languages from Niklaus Wirth became a bit famous, the Pascal successors, Modula, Oberon. And at that time, I was very convinced by the benefits of those languages. I didn't really use them because they were not as widely available as C and were not as interesting from that standpoint. But I thought from a language point of view, they had improvements about C, like for example, you have structured flow graphs. You usually don't have cryptic expressions, the mixing of expressions and statements that you have in C, or side effects in expressions, or many different ways to express what you're doing that you have in C. And at that time, those were convincing arguments for me. But if I look at it now, I don't really think those are necessarily benefits. I don't think that is necessarily better for humans. Maybe some quirks are more benefit than a disadvantage. So I haven't seen so far that other languages have made any great breakthroughs, and that it has made software any better by a lot. Apart from, of course, there are some special domains where you can say one language helps a lot in if you do this special kind of program. But I think C is still good enough for a lot of applications, and there are many people who like it and like its quirks probably.
Yeah, and as long as new developers start learning C, it will be used.
Yeah.
Question from the chat, were you ever tempted to add extensions like new keywords?
There are a lot of extensions. VBCC has a lot of non-C extensions. You have inline assembly, you can specify registers for parameters, you have certain pragmas.
Yes, there are extensions already in there. a question here. Do you plan to support the new draft formats like DraftS? I think that is about debugging.
Yes.
Formatting stuff in binaries.
To be honest, I'm not familiar with Dwarf 5. I did implement support for Dwarf 2, I think. And this already was it's not too much fun, because you can do a lot of things in Dwarf 2 already, and then you feed it into a debugger and the debugger just doesn't like it, and you don't get any decent error messages from the debuggers. Barely any debugger supports the entire features of Dwarf. So usually you have a debugger that is designed to work with this or that compiler. And if you do something else, generate the Dwarf info a bit different, then often it does not work very good anymore. And I was glad when I finally got it working in a way that I could use, I think, GDB and what I think the Lauterbach debugger for embedded systems was something I needed to work it with. I'm not sure. I don't even know what are the difference of Dwarf 5. Maybe it also makes it easier. But also, I don't know what debuggers do already support it, so I'd have to look into that, really. I just don't know at the moment.
Do you have any plans for new architectures or or new targets like SyncHQL or RISC-V?
I've always plans. Question is which of them are promising enough that I really start them, and how much time I have. I can say for the SyncHQL, I think this basically would be a port of the libc and the startup code, I think. So I believe that I have seen somebody use VBCC to create code for SyncHQL. I think there was something on the web, maybe Googling for VBCC and SyncHQL might find something. But I think this is something that wouldn't be too much work, but I haven't had a SyncHQL. I don't know anything about it. So this is, for example, a good opportunity for somebody to contribute. If somebody has knowledge about the SyncHQL and wants to do such a target, he can contact me, and then we can do that together. Regarding the RISC V, I think there wouldn't be much sense in a VBCC for it. Usually, I choose a target where a VBCC port can add something. I think RISC-V is probably very, very well supported by GCC and probably LLVM already. Similar like x86 or so, there are very, very good compilers. Doesn't make much sense to add VBCC to them.
Yeah, about the SyncHQL, we had two guests here in the chat talking about the SyncHQL. One was Marcel Kilgus. He works on the operating system kernel for the SyncHQL, for one of the operating systems there. And as far as I remember, there is, I think, not really supported C compiler anymore. So it would make sense, and maybe I can somehow I will research if there have been already attempts to use VBCC on the QL, and maybe I can push the community a little bit to look into that.
Yeah.
So we are already above the 1 hour mark, and let's see if we have some questions. Yeah, here's a command last C compiler for QL is C68. Did you or do you know someone tried compiling NetServe, which is a web browser, a lightweight for smaller machines?
No, I don't know. Isn't this C++? I'm not sure. Is this the engine behind Firefox or
no? No, it's I think it's completely independent from both Firefox and Chrome. So it's an own browser with limited JavaScript and CSS, but still quite usable.
Okay.
So in general, what is your experience? Because most C code that someone can find today is written and tested with GCC and maybe LLVM. How compatible is VBCC if it reads, tries to parse code written for GCC? Is that a major problem, or is it just some basic going over the code and maybe one, two, three lines that needs to be changed?
That depends entirely on the code. VBCC does not try to be compatible with all the GCC extensions. So if I want to add an extension and GCC already has this extension and the way that it's done in GCC is fine for me, then I will probably do it the same way. But if it would be more work to be compatible with GCC than doing another extension or doing it another way, then I will not put in the work to try to be compatible with GCC. For example, the inline assembly is handled very differently in VBCC. But the way I implemented it was very simple. I think it's also very intuitive for people to use it, and it was not much work to implement it in VBCC. It was a very simple addition, whereas the inline assembly in GCC is very cryptic, and it probably still wouldn't have been really compatible, because you can get the syntax similar, but then at some point you still will have problems. So if the code relies very deeply on GCC specifics, you tend to have more problems. If it just uses a few features, for example, if you use inline assembly at a few places in your code, then you will get a pass error at this location, and then you see, okay, I need to adapt this, and then it's reasonably simple. For example, on the Amiga, there are many include files which do some compiler abstraction, so that you can do all the specific stuff you need to do for the Amiga in a way that will be translated by a header file into whatever VBCC or GCC or another Amiga compiler needs.
The question here, how much effort does it take to write a new backend? Is there any documentation to help, or do someone has to figure out that from the source code?
No, you don't have to figure it out from the source code. The documentation of VBCC contains a chapter interface, backend interface, which describes the backend interface and describes the steps you have to take to write a backend. what functions you need to write, what the data structures have to look like, and so on. And there is also a generic backend, it's called, which is kind of a template backend, which doesn't really generate a working code, but more for symbolic machine, and which you can even by command line options, I think you can tell it whether how many registers it has, and whether it has two address or three address instructions, and whether it's just a load store architecture, or if it has memory operands. And then you can start pretty fast using this to get the first simple programs compiled, and then continue adapting this to your own machine. So the feedback I got from people who wrote backends is that this works quite well and gets you pretty fast up to your first results. In the end, still writing a backend is not entirely trivial. The amount of work also depends on what are your goals. Do you just want working code, or do you want very good code, which can make a lot of difference? Just simple, inefficient backend can be much, much simpler than a very highly optimized backend. And also how much features you want to support. For example, do you only support data types which your target machine natively supports, or do you want to support larger types where you need several registers, like long types or something like this? Or do you need a complete? Does it have to be a complete backend, or do you only want a subset of features that you use for your own code? So it's a pretty big spectrum of how much work it can be. And also the target machine, for example, the QNICE FPGA is where I have done a backend, was very, very simple. It's a very clean architecture because it's more or less a theoretical one. Whereas, for example, the 6502 is pretty much where you think, yeah, if somebody asked me and said, please design an architecture which is theoretically able to run C programs, but make it about as hard as possible to support it, then that's probably what you come up with.
Yes, 6502 is not easy for C. Do you sometimes compare VBCC code quality and code size with other C compilers?
Yes. Not all the time. For example, for the 68K, I have done it a lot when I first wrote it. I haven't done it so much in more recent times, but for example, now when I started the 6502 backend or the one for the 8609, then of course I tried to look what compilers are there and how is the code quality, and does it make sense? Or sometimes even look at them before I start the backend to check whether it makes sense to write a backend, or you can say there is already a very fine compiler, then there's no need for another one, perhaps.
There's one question here, which I'm not 100% sure how that is meant. Any plans to support basics like GFA basic? I guess that's about a front end that parses basic and spits out binary code.
Okay, it's a bit the same direction like the Objective-C. I don't have any concrete plans to support this. I think also that BASIC is already quite a bit more away from C than, for example, Objective-C is, and I don't know if it makes so much sense. But also, at least I can say no concrete plans.
So here's not a question, but a comment that I want to read. Still, I just want to say that I'm very impressed with VBCC and what has been achieved. It's totally awesome and helps a lot keeping retro computing alive. And we get it for free with Deutsche Qualität. Thank you so much.
Thanks, you're welcome.
So I think I'm out of questions. Let me quickly check the chat if I have skipped something there. And if someone has open questions, now is the time, or later when we turn off the recording and then we have the informal chat. No, I think it's everything there. Oh, there's one. Also, I think just a comment is there's no C compiler for the HP 68000 series computers, series 200 computers. Could be an interesting target.
Yeah, don't know those machines. Are those 68K based?
Yeah, I think it seems to be HP 68K series 200. I don't know them either. But they seems to be out there. Depends on how many working machines are still available. So it wouldn't make sense if there's just 10 machines, but not sure. Never seen that. There's another question from Philip is, do you have a local compiler explorer instance with VBCC integrated? Which is the compiler explorer at godbolt.org. Not sure if you know that.
Yeah, I've been, somebody pointed me to this, I think, some time ago. So I've seen it, but no, I have not.
Yes, about this, the person asking is the question about the HP 68K. We'll need to do a presentation about series 200 machines. Yes, certainly. I'm always happy to get volunteers to talk about 68K machines here in the chat. Please contact me. I think there was a lot of questions and a lot of good answers. So thank you, Volker, for the first part here. And I will stop the recording now.